Blackstone Audio presents The Bottom of Your Heart, The Inferno for Commissario Ricciardi by Maurizio de Giovanni. Translated by Anthony Sugar. This book is read by Grover Gardner. For Paolo Repetti's Big Hidden Heart. 1. The professor is falling. He's falling, and as he falls, he spreads his arms wide as if trying to embrace the scorching summer night that stretches out to catch him. He's falling, and since the brief struggle knocked all the air out of his lungs, his body now pointlessly demands that he take a deep breath, even though the new lung full of oxygen won't do him a bit of good, won't even have a chance to make it into his bloodstream. For that matter, his nose won't even register the scents from the blossoms on the trees and the flowers blooming in their beds, the smells from the open kitchen windows throughout the neighborhood, which is immersed in the blistering heat as if in some curse. He falls with his eyes closed, ignoring the lights still burning in the windows of those unable to get to sleep, despite the lateness of the hour, or further out, beyond the roofs of the apartment buildings that slope down to the sea, the streetlights lining the boulevard that marks the end of the network of narrow lanes, the vicoli of Naples. The professor is falling, and as he does, his thoughts shatter into a thousand tiny shards, flickerings of consciousness that will never again construct one of those well-turned phrases for which he is so justly renowned in the lecture halls of the School of Medicine. By now, those flickerings are like so many fragments of a broken mirror, reflecting what little they can catch in the fall, yearning for the days when they could assemble a single harmonious picture. One of those shards catches a flicker of love. If only he could linger over the topic, the professor would muse on the strangeness of love. It makes you do such strange things, things you would never usually do. Love sometimes makes you ridiculous, and other times fills your life with color. Love creates, and love destroys, he would say, employing one of his proverbial figures of speech. Love can even throw you out a window. But the professor is falling, and when you're falling, you can afford nothing more than a few scattered shards of thought. And so the fertile scientific mind accepts the fear of pain. Pain is something you can study, the professor would declare, if he had the time and the leisure. Pain is a symptom, a sign that the complex machinery of the human body, about which we know so much and yet so little, is not functioning as it ought to be. A signal, a flashing warning light that demands attention. Hurry, come running, something's wrong. With children, the professor would tell us, if only he weren't falling, this is the problem. They can't tell us where it hurts. They don't understand the things they feel. They sob, they weep despairingly, but they say nothing. And the poor physician trying to cure the little devils has to blunder around in the dark, palpating here and there until a shout louder than the rest gives him a clue. You're cold, cold. You're getting warmer, hot. If only he weren't falling at dizzying speed, the professor would reflect for the thousandth time about the strangeness of life, which can lead you to involve yourself professionally in matters you'd usually steer clear of. He, for instance, could never stand children, not even when he was a child himself, the morose only son of a work-obsessed provincial businessman and a weepy schoolteacher whose unctuous hugs he avoided like the plague. But there's not much you can do about it, he would have said with a shrug, if he hadn't been so busy windmilling his arms through the warm night air. A job is a job, and since women produce children and his profession involved women, he necessarily had to work with children. The professor is falling, and in a flash he realizes that there is no more time, even though the fall is lasting much longer than he ever would have expected. There's no time to get back into shape, in the hopes of surviving the struggle that culminated in his being tossed out the window with such laughable ease, which is, after all, the reason he's now falling. And to think that he was proud of his smooth, sensitive surgeon's hands, so different from the rough, calloused hands of the many seekers who begged him to treat them, hats in hand and pockets empty. He was even proud of his flaccid flesh and double chin, clear signs of opulent dinners and highly placed friends, the envy of his jealous colleagues. If
only he'd been. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.